Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, it is your boy, Dull X-Man, and once again, we are live here for my WWE review. We are reviewing SmackDown Live and 205 Live, July 31st of 2018, the last day for July, the month I was born. It was quite the month, both emotionally and, well, I guess I can say physically. I've been changing because I've been working out as well, been improving on myself, trying to make myself better, both professionally and personally. And I look forward to what else 2018 has in store for me. But you guys are looking forward to what I have to say in terms of this show and, well, these shows. Trust me, we got a lot to talk about. If you like what I have to say and you're not subscribed to your boy, Dull X-Man, do yourself a favor. Click that subscribe button and like the video. You can also share this on any social media platform. While you're at it, like me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, and check out everything down below in the description box, as well as links to my PayPal and Patreon. You can also donate using Super Chat. But most importantly, if you want to help expand the brand of your boy, Dull X-Man, buy yourself a Dull X-Man t-shirt today. And Pro Wrestling Tees, we're kicking things off with a Super Chat. Aaron Sherry.
Raw rumors behind SmackDown make the hype for SF.
Tell me about it. Raw killed my excitement for SummerSlam in a way. SmackDown, thankfully, was able to make it interesting.
I might get hate for this, but why is Charlotte added to the Mel and Becky match? Get someone. Tell me why. I just hope Becky doesn't lose.
Oh, trust me, Notorious, I think your reaction was a universal reaction. I think everybody was wondering why the hell is Charlotte taking Becky's spotlight. You know? We're just kicking it off with Super Chats. Let's go.
Thoughts on Ryan, Christopher, and Volkov's deaths.
I already talked about them in my last podcast. That was the Women's Evolution podcast, but I'll give my quick thoughts again. Very sad. Nikolai Volkov, one of the best heels in the business, made a name for himself working with people like the Iron Sheik and Hulk Hogan back in the early 80s. One of the very first foreign heels to really make an impact in the world of wrestling. And in real life, he was a very nice guy and inspired a lot of talent nowadays to do what they do. Sad to lose him. Even sadder for Brian Christopher, aka Grandmaster Sexy, one half of Too Cool, or a third of Too Cool. Recently did a review on SummerSlam 2000. He was on that show. And man, it's sad when you go back and watch those shows knowing that these guys passed away. Doesn't make it any easier. But the fact that he tried to commit suicide, you know, well, he attempted suicide, but ended up dying anyway, so maybe he was successful. Who knows? That's sad. But rest in peace. Not much else to say. If you want more details, I suggest you go watch people like Solid Monster and Good Mike Work, who do a better job at this than I do. But those are my thoughts on those two. So, let's kick things off with 205 Live. We got some updates from 205 Live, and then we're going to get into SmackDown Live. But first, roll call. Who is here in the live chat? Who is here watching your boy Dull X-Man? We got Goku Black, Sammy B, Bryson Mixtape 99, Ultra Shadow 97, The Fox, Anthony, this is a hard name to pronounce, but let's see if I can do it. Anthony Fabricator. Fabricator? Rats, Braun Strowman, Jay Knox, who is known for making my covers, Black Cyborg, Bishop Johnson, see Jake Saleh, I'm Your Dad, Kid 25, that's a new name, welcome, Awesome Kid 2254, we got Cindy McGonagall, OG Wade, Gustavo Retinella, Leo Gallimora, perhaps, I'm great with names, look at me go, Joseph Winters, the Too Cool Crew, who donated, Ramel Flemmy, sure, Otaku, let's see, they're coming fast now, here they come. Oh, they're going real fast. Okay. Spinosaurus. The Sniper Wolf. Hellraiser. Sam P. Boone. Raheem Isaac. Josiah. Rose. Alaska. Close enough. Oh, yeah, Mr. Krabs. Thank you for the super chat.
Hard to watch Chris and
want to
know what he did.
You're not the only one, buddy. Okay, a few more. Truth Fighter 901, Godzilla Hulk, Keon Cody, The Cast, Lazy Cheese, and finally, let's do Alexis Simmons. Alright, thank you. If I don't say your name, it's not because I'm ignoring you. There are so many people here. I had to say a couple of you and then get right to the show. So, let's go ahead and start off with 205 Live and chase the cover real quick. And boom, 205 Live is here. So, tonight's episode, featured Cedric Alexander taking on Brian Kendrick in the main event. It was like a warm-up match, I suppose. A warm-up match before he fights Drew Gulak at SummerSlam. It was announced on this show that he will be fighting, defending his belt against Drew Gulak at SummerSlam, and we're going to assume it's going to be on the pre-show, because why would they have the Cruiserweights open SummerSlam? You know, why would they ever do that? Especially since SummerSlam's going to be, I can't stress this enough, it's going to be 6 hours long. That includes the pre-show, by the way, but that's way too long. So they had a contract signing between Drew Gulak and Cedric Alexander for SummerSlam. They did it backstage. Of course, GM Drake Maverick was in charge of the signing. Before Gulak signed it, he started talking. He questions Cedric's work ethic and calls him a lazy champion. And Cedric tried to shut him up, let him know that he's been trying, or he has been defending his belt all over the world. It's just not been on TV. But Gulak says he's full of crap. He says while him and his partners, that would be Jimmy Jack Gallagher and Brian Kendrick, have been the workhorses of 205 Live, Cedric has been relaxing, chilling backstage, and doing nothing. He then goes all the way and calls Cedric the Brock Lesnar of 205 Live. They have turned Brock Lesnar into a joke at this point. It's literally taboo to be Brock Lesnar. That's where we are at Brock Lesnar, where we can literally use him as an insult. You are the Brock Lesnar 205 Live. Remember when calling yourself the Brock Lesnar or anything would mean you're a badass? Now it's an insult. You're the Brock Lesnar 205 Live. Jesus. Cedric tells them to watch what he does to Brian tonight, because all the anger he has for him, he's going to take out. He's going to take out his friend. They signed the contract and that's what we got. So, interesting. Interested in that SummerSlam match. We got a couple of other matches. Kalisto beat Tony Nese. Solid match overall. Afterwards, we see Buddy Murphy go out and confront Kalisto. He goes to, you know, bully him around a little bit until Lince Dorado gets out there. And they super kick poor Buddy Murphy. Let's see where that leads. We also got Leo Rush competing in a squash match. Forgot the name of the talent? Don't ask me. I'll probably need to go look it up just to get it back. But essentially, he squashes him in seconds. Still a lot of cool things. This guy's the real deal. Lio Rush is everything he's been praised as. He can talk. He can wrestle. He has a good look. The guy is awesome. So is the Super Jack.
Hear about the Young Bucks versus For Jericho's Rock and Wrestling was announced.
Oh, okay. Young Bucks versus LAX? Wait, which LAX? The originals or the new version? Because if it's Homicide and Hernandez versus Young Bucks, I'm there. But if it's the new LAX, I don't know about that. If it's the OGs, I'm all for it, man. Regardless, back to Lio Rush after he beat the local talent. Out walks Akira Tozawa. Now, Lio Rush cut a promo before the match, telling the world that he really doesn't need to fight Akira again. He beat him once, just need to fight him again. Simple as that. Tozawa comes out and basically gets in his face and I guess tries to, you know, fight him or make him give him another match, and Lio Rush just walks away. So we're building more for their eventual rematch. And then we get the main event, Cedric Alexander versus Brian Kendrick. I don't know why it's hard for me to say Cedric Alexander. I just gotta slow that down. Cedric Alexander. So Cedric had a pretty good match with Brian Kendrick. Doesn't meet up to the standard of the matches we've seen in the past, like with Mustafa Ali and Buddy Murphy. Not really. But it was still a good match, and it showcased what Cedric was all about. And it was noted that Cedric so far is undefeated in 2018. He has not lost a match at any time this year, which lets you know he's about to lose. Anytime they announce that this guy has gone this long undefeated, it's basically their way of saying, yeah, we'll let you know that he hasn't really lost a match, you know, in a while, because it's about time for him to lose. So, it's looking like Drew's going to get that belt. I have my thoughts about that, because quite frankly, well, I'll save my actual opinions on who will win for the SummerSlam preview. But for right now, you know, it's a nice match to have.
The current Impact Tag Champions, LAX, not the OGs.
See, that's different. I don't really have that much investment in the new LAX yet. Like, if it was Homicide and Hernandez taking on Young Bucks, I'm all in. No pun intended. But, we'll have to see. But there you go. That was 205 Live. So, give me your thoughts about that down below. How do you feel about the Cruiserweight match? Do you think Cedric will remain champion for long? Or do you think eventually we're going to get the new Drew Gulak as our champion? Now, that's it for 205 Live. Let's go to SmackDown. So we're switching gears over to the Superior main roster show. And let's be real here, guys. When it comes to SmackDown, wait, boom, there it is. I just feel like, and I keep saying this, because a lot of people think that I'm just overrating the show and liking it because it's not Raw. While that is true, in a sense, you know, it's kind of hard not to give praise to a show that just does everything right. In terms of making a show, they just do everything by the books. They're not doing anything spectacular. They're not doing, like, God work. They're not changing the game. They're just doing everything by the book. That's all SmackDown's doing. They're just doing everything the right way. Or at least a way that works. And Raw just does everything wrong. Yes, it does make me appreciate it just a little bit more. Plus, the 2 hours doesn't help. You know, 2 hours doesn't help Raw either. So, look, you can say all you want that I like this show because it's not Raw. But let's just be real here. There's a lot of good things happening on SmackDown. So I know a lot of people are just sick of the main roster, and I understand. I can at least say SmackDown, the show SmackDown, I can at least believe is doing everything right. Now, will this bleed over into SummerSlam? I have no idea. I don't know what team is right in SummerSlam. Let's just hope, you know, whatever SmackDown's doing, the people out right in SmackDown will also be in charge of this stuff at SummerSlam, and it's not going to get over into what's happening with Raw. Regardless, I think this show, especially tonight, has been very entertaining. I think, in terms of getting me excited for SummerSlam, SmackDown's been doing a really good job. I think right now, we have a good set of SmackDown matches set for SummerSlam. I don't think we need to add any more. We'll probably add one more, and that's the United States Championship match. We're getting ready to know what the tag match is. I can predict what that's going to be, without question. But I do feel like, and this is just my opinion, I do feel like if you're going to be watching main roster WWE, you should probably stick to SmackDown and just stop watching Raw. Because that's what I'm going to do. If Raw doesn't improve over the next 2 weeks, at least until the Raw after SummerSlam, yeah, I'm just going to be done. Because this show, at the very least, does everything right in terms of how to write a wrestling show. Is it breaking new ground? Is it, you know, creating a whole new era? No, it's just a solid wrestling show. And when you have a solid wrestling show following a crappy wrestling show like Raw, the solid wrestling show is always going to come off much more better. So there you go. You know, if you're wondering why I like SmackDown more than Raw, yeah, you can argue all you want. It's not Raw. That's why you like it better. But at the same time, SmackDown clearly is a better show. It's shorter. It's 2 hours. It has better talent. It has better writing. It has more interesting stories, stronger characters. Why would anybody else argue that Raw is better than SmackDown? I mean, if you want actual money details, SmackDown is getting it's at least $1 billion. I forgot the actual number. But SmackDown is the one getting paid $1 billion for Fox, not Raw. Just saying. Anyways, let's get into it. So we open up SmackDown with Becky Lynch. She comes out to do a promo with our favorite interviewer, Brittany Young. Becky reminds the world of her struggles to become a champion. She has not had, well, let's start off with this first. She hasn't held the belt since December 2016, but watch this. She hasn't gotten a title shot, not the title, but a title shot since WrestleMania 33. Becky Lynch went a year and a half. Literally a year and a half without a title shot, not a title match, not holding the title, but a title shot, and that's discouraging. That really lets you know how much Road Dogg did not like this girl. And I know a lot of people are going to say, well, blame it on Kevin Dunn because he hates people with accents and all that kind of stuff. But for real, think about this. Becky Lynch's championship drought, just so happened to happen while Road Dogg was writing SmackDown. And since Road Dogg is now producing Raw, and SmackDown has gone back to who was writing SmackDown before, I'm assuming Ryan Ward, now Becky Lynch is all of a sudden back in the title picture. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? I'm not trying to say one connects to the other. Really, come on now, for real. But it's interesting how, all of a sudden, out of the blue, Becky Lynch is back on top, right? She's the focal point of the story again. Regardless, she talks about not being given a title shot since WrestleMania 33, but she says winning the opportunity recently has stopped her from sleeping. She's been thinking about becoming the fighting champion we all deserve and representing the universe as the SmackDown Women's Champion for the upcoming women's pay-per-view. You all knew it was going to somehow be slid into this. It's WWE. So, I'm just at that point where it's like, okay, guys, like, for real, don't overhype this show. It's 3 months away. I understand you want people to know about it. Okay, but can we wait until after SummerSlam? You don't have to keep mentioning it in every single freaking episode. But, sorry, getting back to this. Basically, Becky tells the world that she will win the Women's Championship, and that's when Carmella comes out. And this is when it got really good. Because I think Carmella cut one of her best promos, in her career. Not just on the main roster or NXT, in her entire career. She talks about how disappointed she's been in herself. Failing to live up to the standard she set for herself, and always feeling like she was trailing behind Becky Lynch.
Becky is my favorite of all the women. Hopefully, she somehow gets the belt in his ass.
I'll have more to say about that in a second, but she's a favorite for a lot of them, buddy. Not the only person with that. But, what was I saying? More super chats. Okay.
Say what you will about Mel, she cut the promo.
Oh, I don't think anybody is disputing that, buddy. We all know Bella here can cut that promo. Now, like I was saying, she comes out and she starts talking about how she's been a disappointment as a champion. Well, to herself. And how she feels she's been trailing Becky. And NXT, she was always seen as a valet, while Becky was considered one of the best female talents coming up. On SmackDown, Becky was the first draft pick, female draft pick, and the first women's champion, while Carmella was basically an afterthought. She was directionless. She said she's always been jealous of Becky, feeling like she can't live up to her. More so now, since no one believes she is a legit women's champion. And you can just tell. The words that Carmella was saying, although character-wise, she's playing Becky. You know the villain is going to do something, you know, conniving and sneaky. And she's basically fooling Becky. But the person behind the character, like the real-life person playing Carmella, you can tell she was genuinely speaking words she felt. Because I would believe, I don't even know what Carmella's real name is, but I would believe Carmella would feel that way because it's a reality. She has been trailing Becky. She has been an afterthought on SmackDown. She was at one point seen as a valet. No one took her seriously as a legit wrestler. So, those feelings, you can tell, were genuine. Those are genuine feelings coming out, which makes this promo work. And this is what, my goodness, this is why I like SmackDown more than Raw. It's the genuineness. It's the idea that you believe what's happening. You could believe what Carmella was talking about. You can believe what she was saying was real words. And that's how you get people invested. It doesn't feel artificial. It feels real. Continuing, Carmella tells Becky, congratulations on getting a title shot. And she reaches out her hand. Oh, Lord.
Should I go to take over LA Survivor Series?
Is that even a question? Go to TakeOver, bro. Buy your ticket, go to TakeOver. If you can go to both, go for it, but really, TakeOver is the show you need to go to. But, getting back to this, Carmella tells Becky congratulations on having a title shot, and then reaches out her hand out of respect, letting her know that we're about to make history with this women's pay-per-view, and we should be cordial about it. That's when James Ellsworth music hits. And we're expecting him to come out, and he doesn't come out. It was a ploy for Carmella to attack Becky from behind. And that's when the boos happened, She starts smiling like she tricked Becky. She grabs a steel chair and goes to DDT Becky on the chair until Charlotte shows up, makes a return, and saves her. As a result, first off, welcome back, Charlotte. We're going to get into what everybody wants me to talk about in just a second. But this was a hot segment. This was a really strong segment to kick off SmackDown, which is immediately followed by a big announcement. We see Carmella go backstage to meet Paige, and Paige is not happy about what Carmella did. Paige feels like she was disrespectful in her disingenuousness when she told Becky about how she felt about being, you know, a disappointment for herself and all that kind of stuff, not representing the women and all that jazz. And Paige being someone that takes the women's evolution seriously, she felt Carmella using it for her own ends was not cool. And Carmella said, look, what you gonna do about it? I'm the champion. I am something you will never, ever be again, a women's champion. Which, you know, pissed off Paige, knowing that she can't wrestle anymore because she's not cleared by WWE. She's in the exact same spot Bryan was in years ago. So, yeah. Paige was not happy about it, so what did she do? She put Carmella in a match against Charlotte in the main event. And here's the kicker. If Charlotte beats Carmella, she will be added to the match, and it will be a triple threat. Ooh. Ooh. See, as soon as that was announced, my first reaction, and I'll even show you on Twitter, my first reaction was, okay, we're not going to have Charlotte step in on Becky's opportunity, are we? Like, maybe someone like Asuka is going to interfere and cost Charlotte the match. Because this is just something for drama. We're just playing this up for drama to make fans get a little scared that Becky's not going to get the title at SummerSlam. Maybe we'll have Asuka go out there and cost Charlotte the match. Why? Because it makes sense. Asuka's been on a losing streak since she lost to Charlotte. She would hold a grudge against Charlotte. You know, get that rematch at SummerSlam. Maybe she feels like if I beat you, I get back on the right track. So that's what I was thinking. I was thinking, okay, Asuka's going to come out, interfere in the match, and then we'll be fine. That's not exactly what happened. And we'll get to that in a second. But we'll have a lot to talk about when we get there. Moving on from that, The New Day. They come out for commentary on this next match. It is The Bar taking on The Usos. The Bar being Cesaro and Sheamus. This is their first match back in how long? Months. Regardless, look, I'm assuming this was a good match. Unfortunately, it was interrupted by two commercial breaks. And I hate that. When you have a match like this, don't interrupt it. And if you're going to interrupt it, if you're going to interrupt it, at least show the match during the commercial breaks. I don't like that we had what I would have really enjoyed, a tag match between two really good tag teams. And it was just when I was getting into a commercial break. It was split and kind of tainted by commercial breaks. I guess that's the breaks. Then the breaks. We're having matches on the actual main roster, but whatever. What matters is The Bar wins. Cesaro and Sheamus end up beating the Usos, which is a heartbreaker because, in case I don't know this, the Usos have never had a main roster, a non-pre-show match on SummerSlam. They've never been on the main card for SummerSlam. Never. Usos have been here since 2010, and they have yet to have a main card match on SummerSlam. They had their first main card WrestleMania match this year, but they can't be on SummerSlam now. And that kind of hurts me, although I kind of figured they weren't going to win anyways. You could have at least played into that. But it's going to be The Bar. Cesaro and Sheamus taking on The New Day next week, and the winners of that were going to face the Bludgeon Brothers. Spoiler alert, it won't be The New Day. Just saying. Now, we get to one of my favorite parts of the show. Samoa Joe. So Samoa Joe came out to cut a promo, and as you guys know, anytime Samoa Joe grabs a microphone, that mic becomes golden. He is one of the best promo cutters in the world, and he showed it here. Get to that after the super chat. Yeah.
Jake the Awesome lost to Charlotte W. and Broker.
Yeah. You know, that's the idea of a storytelling that I was going for. So, here we go. Samoa Joe comes out. He grabs the microphone. The first thing he says is that he respects AJ Styles. He respects the house that he built. And he respects that he made the WWE Championship the most prestigious belt in the world. He put being the best over everything. Even being a member of his own family. See, this is when he starts cutting deep into AJ Styles. Joe claims AJ is so obsessed with being the best, he's hardly at home being a father to his daughter and being a husband to his wife. It's a sacrifice being the best, but he straight up tells him that AJ Styles is a failure as a father and a failure as a husband. Ooh! Oh, we're getting personal, and I like it. We're not done yet. We're not done. So he continues. He tells them he's not worthy of being called a champion. But at the same time, he should not worry. Because after SummerSlam, things will change. Because see, while everybody is, well, while all the fans are rooting for AJ Styles to beat Samoa Joe, Joe is confident that AJ's family is rooting for Joe to win, because they know once AJ Styles loses, Daddy will be coming home. Yo. And then he just goes on this rant, basically saying he will tear down the house that AJ built, burn everything he's worked for, and walk away as your WWE champion. Joe is a promo god. Man, this promo was fire. This promo cut deep, and it was very personal. I loved it. I loved everything about this promo. This was perfect. This is the exact kind of thing I'm talking about, why I like SmackDown better than Raw. You won't get this promo on Raw. You just won't. Oh, Lord. I agree.
Some angry mother complained that their kids were crying during the Hardy Orton segment.
I heard about that too. We'll get to that in just a second. But yeah, like, just to continue with this promo, this is the kind of stuff that makes me like SmackDown more than Raw. Joe cut a promo from the heart. This isn't a promo that you can say was scripted. Some of you are saying, okay, maybe it was planned. Maybe he written it out beforehand and he got approved by them or something like that, whatever. But there's no way a writer, some guy randomly went up to Joe and just wrote this down and told him to say, hell, this was Joe. This was all Joe. This came straight from the mind of Samoa Joe, and those are the best promos. It's not ones given to you in a script. And the fact that this guy was able to make it this personal without even, you know, without even doing much lets you know who we're dealing with. This guy's a beast. But I like it because it's giving me super chats.
I hope Jeff Hardy wins the WWE title at WM35.
It's a little too soon to be looking forward to WrestleMania 35, so I don't know if Jeff Hardy's going to win the WWE title. Not yet, at least. But we'll have to see. Never say never. But the reason why I like this so much is more super chats. They're coming in.
Samoa Joe cut an Ultra Instinct promo there, damn.
Ultra Instinct, I like that. I like the way you put me through that in. But, yeah, it is very, very personal the way he was able to cut deep like that. And why I like it is because it's, I can't talk right now. These super chats are just coming in. Guys!
Okay, I mean, I'm cool with the super chats. Just keep them coming.
If WWE is trying to make this a kid show, they might as well move over to the Disney Channel or Nickelodeon. In other words, screw them.
Wow. I don't know if it's gonna get that bad. Okay, let me go ahead and get this out before another super chat shows up. Alright. The reason why I like this promo is because it's relatable. When you look at AJ Styles, you look at his career, you look at what he's going through, there is this sense of, you know, I don't wanna say loneliness, but you can tell there's a price to being the best in the world. And who knows what trials AJ Styles deals with on a regular basis. You know, this guy must be thinking, all right, here I am, busting my ass, hurting my body. I'm 40 years old. I'm not 25. I'm not 30 anymore. I'm in my 40s. And the stuff that I used to be able to do and just walk away like it's nothing, I can barely even walk away from. My body is breaking down on me. My age is catching up with me. And all I'm thinking about is being there for my daughter, being there for my wife. And I'm hardly there. I'm on the road 24/7. I'm wrestling 3, 4, 5 times a week. And I only see them over phone. You know, the sacrifices he's made just to be the best in the world, it's not an easy thing to deal with. But while you feel sorry for him, you also respect AJ Styles. It makes you like him even more. But what I also love about it is that it does set up for a devastating loss if he does indeed lose to Joe. Imagine now, knowing that this is going to be the story, how devastating it will be to see AJ Styles lose. Lose to a guy who basically said that he is going to end his career, that he's going to send him home to his daughter and his mother, his daughter and his wife, and yeah, even his mother. But, you know what's sad about this too? Spoiler alert, I think Joe's winning the belt. Early prediction for SummerSlam. I think Joe is taking that belt from AJ. AJ's held that belt for, what? He won it in November. So, September, October, November. What is that, 8, 9 months? 9 months as champion? Are you kidding me? That's a strong run. A really strong run as a WWE champion. Combined, he's held that belt because he's held the belt twice now. So a combined length would be about a year. So AJ Styles is going down in history as one of the best champions, period. Without question. Without question. Thing is, though, this needs to be said. If you are going to put that belt on Samoa Joe, if Samoa Joe is going to be the monster that we all know he can be, he needs his victory. Joe needs this victory. AJ will be all right. He can take this loss, get a rematch, and he'll be able to move on and do other things and work with other people. He doesn't need to hold the belt anymore. Samoa Joe, on the other hand, yeah, he needs this victory. He needs this victory. That's all I'm going to say about that. So we'll get more from AJ next week. Apparently he's going to show up and he's going to cut a promo. And let's see where this goes. I want AJ to come out. Look, AJ's been doing pretty well on the microphone, especially compared to what he was doing in TNA. I don't know what the hell that was. He's been pretty good on the microphone since coming to WWE. But I want to see what he has to say next week. If we're getting personal like this, I want AJ to go there as well. I want to see him go. I want to see him go there. Because Joe went there. Let's keep it going. Let's make this the true main event of SummerSlam. And we're moving on. So, the next promo we got was Jeff Hardy coming out to call out Randy Orton. Hardy says he lost a piece of himself when Nakamura took away his U.S. Championship. And nothing matters more to him than getting it back. Except getting his hands on the Viper, Randy Orton. That's when he calls him out.
calls out Mr. RKO, and unlike most cowardly heels, Reggie Young just walks right out. Before Orton gets to the ring, though, Jeff Hardy is blindsided by Shinsuke Nakamura. Now, Nakamura immediately goes to hit his Kinshasa, but Reggie Orton steps in his way, and they have a stare-off. And let's stop right here and talk about this stare-off. When Reggie Orton and Nakamura had a stare-off, the crowd gave, like, this unified, you know what I'm saying? It was like, oh, shoot. It's funny to me that we did this exact same thing in 2017. Barely got a reaction. Barely. We do this here. This same thing a year later with Nakamura and Randy Orton. And oh my god, we want to see this match. Notice how instantly Randy Orton versus Nakamura became when these two became interesting characters. You turn Randy Orton heel, you make Nakamura a heel. Holy crap, now we want to see this match. And you know what, fans? I want to see it too. I'm right there with you. I think Nakamura versus Randy Orton now would be freaking amazing. It'd be a freaking awesome match. With the way their characters are, let's go. I'd be all over that match. But of course, that's going to have to come later because the story is all about Jeff Hardy. Now, speaking of Jeff Hardy, Orton decides to step out of the way and allow Nakamura to hit his Kinshasa, which he does. Knocks the tape down the throat of Mr. Jeff Hardy and then walks away. That's when Randy Orton proceeds to grab Jeff Hardy by his neck and beat him down. And then teases an RKO. He teases it. He just, I'm going to RKO, guys. Come on, guys. Hey, you ready? Are you getting excited? Goes down to the ground, pounds the mat. And then when Jeff Hardy stands up, he just trips him. He basically taunted the audience that he was going to do the RKO and doesn't do it to piss them off. What a heel. He doesn't give a damn anymore. I love this Randy Orton. Please don't ever turn him babyface. Oh, we're not done yet. So he drags Jeff Hardy to the outside of the ring, hits another Hangman DDT on the outside concrete, throws him on the announcer table, and then, watch this, takes Jeff Hardy's shirt, rips it off, grabs Jeff Hardy's chain necklace that had his logo on it, rips that off, goes to the other side of the timekeeper desk, grabs a napkin and a bottle of water, spray bottle, and then proceeds. It wasn't even a spray bottle, it was just a bottle of water, I think. But he grabs that stuff, goes over to Jeff Hardy, pours the water on Jeff's face, and proceeds to wipe away his face paint. Basically saying he is going to destroy, or he destroyed Jeff Hardy's identity. He doesn't just want to hurt Jeff Hardy. He wants to end Jeff Hardy. He wants to eliminate, destroy the identity of Jeff Hardy. And then he walks away. Man, Orton is awesome. Like, that's the kind of stuff I wish WWE would have done with him so many times before. He should have never turned babyface. It was a mistake making him a babyface. Yeah, never turn him babyface again. And to the person who asked me about the kids crying, I did see that and I loved it. I loved seeing the kids cry. I thought it was great. I thought it was amazing. And apparently it was revealed that WWE is no longer PG. It's now PG-13. Did I miss something? When did that happen? So, I guess they can cuss now. Since it's PG-13, they can cuss. I might have to do a video on that. I mean, they said WWE is no longer PG. It's PG-13 now, which is barely PG, I guess. I suppose. But whatever. I liked it. If I have to predict where this is leading, it'll probably lead to a triple threat. Orton, Nakamura, and Jeff Hardy. Although we already have a triple threat with the Women's Championship, but whatever. Well, we'll get into that in a second. Now,
Zelina, her sexy self, took on Lana in a one-on-one match. Zelina's... What else can I say about Zelina? By a show of hands, who just went, God damn, the moment you saw Zelina walk out on stage? You did? Okay. And I know everybody did. Men and women. God damn! You know what I'm saying? But, basically, Zelina ends up beating Lana due to an unintended distraction from Aiden English. English tries to apologize to Lana backstage, and she basically tells him to leave her alone. Let's pause for a minute. Is anybody else noticing that Lana's accent is basically going away? Like, there were hints of it, but she was speaking like a regular, normal American girl. Like, the Russian accent is literally going away. Which, honestly, good. Seriously, I don't even understand why we have her do this now. We should just pull a Kofi Kingston. I thought you were Russian. Have someone call it out. Who cares? I think Lana is even sexier with her regular voice anyways. So why even play up the Russian accent? Whatever. Make her a girl from America. Have her speak regularly. Because she is hot. Regularly anyways. But anyways, we see Rusev basically walk in and see if Lana was okay. Lana says she needed him and he didn't show up. Just more of the deformation of Rusev Day. This is clearly leading to a tag match. Maybe Rusev and Lana versus Andrade Cien Almas and Zelina Vega, where AD English will turn on Rusev or whatever the case. Who knows what's going to happen? But let's see what happens. We have a Daniel Bryan promo. Oh boy. Here we go. Now this promo was nuts. Daniel Bryan comes out. And the first thing he does, you know, we have this guy who was tossed a fake baby last week. You know, someone who has a baby at home, a real baby. Miz basically played on that to beat him down. The first thing that guy talks about is the women's pay-per-view happening in October. Jesus Christ, WWE. Like, for real? Anyways, Bryan brings up the fact that Bree was a part of the match that went 30 seconds and started that whole hashtag give dudes a chance trend on Twitter, which opened up Women's Evolution to happen.
Remember when HHH used to be British?
Yeah, Blue Blood, Hunter, Hearst, Helmsley. Interesting, huh? That's just something WWE does. They just make them British, and then all of a sudden, psych, they're from America. Whatever. But getting back to Bryan's promo, getting past all the evolution stuff, because it's not October. He quickly moves on to last week, where Miz threw a fake baby at him and blindsided him. Bryan brings up for how 2 years, Miz hid behind the fact that Bryan could not wrestle. He was unable to wrestle due to WWE not clearing him to because of an injury. And now he's hiding behind his wife and his baby. He calls out the Miz, and Miz shows up on Titantron. Miz tells Bryan that he is not there, he is on a different, he's in a different location, on location, for shooting of Miz and Mrs. So, he's dipping and dodging him like he should be. Because that's the best way to build this match. Have Miz dip, dodge as much as he can to avoid Bryan. Miz tells Bryan that he has to earn his way to fight him. And that's when Bryan calls Miz a coward. Just like he did on Talking Smack. And that's when Miz brings up Talking Smack and reminds Bryan that when he called Miz is a coward. Bryan walked away. So who really is a coward, right? Miz claims Bryan just wants to... He just wants to start conflict. He wants the conflict because it furthers his career and he's tired of Bryan riding his coattails. Because that's what's happening. He feels like the only reason why Brian is popular is because he has written the Miz's coattails. Brian says, the reality is, Miz, you will never be The Rock. Better yet, you will never be John Cena, because that's what Miz wants to be. That's what he thinks he is. And no one will remember Miz for being a great superstar because he's too soft. So now we're starting to get into the talking smack argument. Now we're intertwining all this stuff into the feud now. Here's where it gets kind of ooh. So Brian calls him out for a match at SummerSlam. And Miz wonders why Brian won't let his contract expire. Miz mentioned that Brian's contract is expiring on TV. Yeah, he just straight up said, your contract is expiring. So why don't you let it expire and go away? Crazy. But then he says, he should go away because all anyone sees him as is this. And then we have these audio clips of babies crying, playing back to back to back to back to back to back to back. And it got a little overbearing. Like, it was a little much. You know, it was weird. And I'll be real with you, I don't know how I feel about the way they portrayed the babies. Like, the way it was done, it seemed a bit much. Like it was a shoot from production. As in, like, the actual WWE executive or the producer team does look at Brian and think he's a crybaby. I mean, he has gone on interviews like, what was that called? Gorilla Position. Where he complained about the creative team. You know, he has voiced his frustration about his booking before. So, maybe they do think he's a crybaby. But why would they do that? Why would they intentionally insult him and try to run him off? Because it's not like he won't take your fan base when he leaves WWE. So I hope that wasn't anything. I'm just looking too hard into it. But it was a bit much. But let's just break this down. The fact that they mentioned Brian's contract expiring tells me one thing and one thing only. They're going to have Brian put his career on the line to fight The Miz. I mean, he's about to leave, right? So why would The Miz not take Brian up on his offer? Maybe what they'll do next week is have Brian come out and say, okay, Miz, since you're so scared of me, I'll make you a deal. I will put my career on the line if you fight me at SummerSlam. And that's the kind of thing that would make Miz fight him. Because then he'll be trying to scheme and connive his way to beating Brian. He'll actually go out of his way to fight Brian if it means he will be out of his hair. And I think that promo alone is going to be fire. When they make that announcement, when Miz finally actually takes Brian up on his offer, because Brian is putting his career on the line, that's going to make me go, wow. Jeez. And I think that's what's going to happen. I do believe that Miz versus Brian will be for Brian's career. It will be a career match. It will be a career match. And I can see Brian doing that. He's so desperate. He's so hungry to punch Miz in the freaking face that he will put his career on the line. So, I'm calling it right now. We're going to get Brian versus Miz, and I do think it will be a career match. That's just my thoughts. I mean, how do you feel about that? Now, we close things off with the main event. Charlotte versus Carmella. Now, let's stop for 1 second and talk about something. I like that SmackDown Live didn't go out of their way to pat themselves on the back for making the women the main event of this show. Because, you know, they're doing this all over the place in terms of evolution. Look at us, we're a great company. We're so great, look at that. You know, it's so annoying. But regardless of all that, we didn't get that tonight on SmackDown. They could have easily come up and said, look at us, to prepare us for evolution, we're going to have the women in the main event on SmackDown tonight. Because look at us, we're a great wrestling company. We promote the women. No, we didn't do that. We just gave them the main event spot and trusted that they'll do well. And I appreciate that. Thank you. All you needed to do was just trust them with the spot and watch them work. And let the crowd decide if they like it or not. And the crowd loved it. It was a pretty solid main event match. I thought it was. Alright, let's get right to it. Through all the craziness, through all the drama, in the end, Charlotte Flair does in fact end up beating Carmella, and the Women's Championship match is now a triple threat at SummerSlam. A lot of people, including Becky Lynch herself, was not happy. Becky was seething with rage. As soon as Charlotte won that belt, they flipped backstage to Becky, just staring that TV screen down like she went to rip it apart. Man, she was pissed. She was angry. And why the hell would she not be angry? Here comes Charlotte. Let's think about this for a minute. Charlotte Flair, the daughter of Ric Flair. Yes, I'm mentioning that because it applies here. This woman has been gone for I don't know how long, at least a month. She comes back, and what happens? She gets an opportunity immediately on her first night back. She gets an opportunity for a title shot. Let's remind ourselves that Becky Lynch hasn't gotten an opportunity since WrestleMania 33, over a year and a half. Over a year and a half with no opportunities for Becky Lynch. Charlotte comes in and on her first night gets a shot.
Becky was about to punch the shit out of that TV.
Tell me about it. Man, I get it. I relate to Becky. I'm right there with Becky. Because why the hell can Charlotte come in?
Watch them head off and make it a fatal four-way.
Okay, I seem to be having a lag right now. Am I good? Sorry about the lag, didn't mean for that to happen. Has it been lagging all night? I want to be sure that the stream has been okay. Has it been alright? Hopefully it's not over. It's not lagging too much. I'm seeing people tell me that it's okay now. Sorry about that. Okay, we're all good. Anyways, I relate to Becky, man. Because I'll be real with you, I like Charlotte. To Becky, man. Because I'll be real with you, I like Charlotte. Charlotte's my girl, she's queen. But really, of all times to come back and get a title shot, why did it have to be during Becky's opportunity? This is Becky's first opportunity in over a year, and here you come getting a title shot. Yeah, I'd be pissed off too. Yeah, it's her friend, I don't give a damn. This was my spotlight. But of course, the queen of nepotism has to come in and get her spotlight. Seriously. Like, it's annoying. Like, I'm mad for Becky. I'm mad with her. Because I'd be pissed off, too. Man, I worked my ass off to get this opportunity. This one opportunity.
I think Miss versus Brian should be a submission match.
Well, regardless, we're gonna get Miz and Ryan. So, submission match, career match, is gonna happen. But getting back to Becky, I don't see how, this is just my thoughts. If WWE was intending to make us, you know, get behind Charlotte with this, I don't think it was gonna work. Personally, I just feel sorry for Becky. Once again, like, her struggles continue. She just can't catch a break. She gets the title shot, finally, after all this time, and what happens? Oh, sorry, it's a triple threat match. What's next? Oh, next week, Asuka's gonna get added to the match. Oh, sorry, it's a fatal four-way match. Oops. You know, I get it. If Becky decides to snap, I wouldn't blame her. Because this is ridiculous. No one asked for Charlotte to be added to this match. They just throw her in there. So of course Becky's pissed off, and I'm pissed off with her, and you know what? I'm just gonna root for her even more. But I thought about this for a minute, because as I was sitting there letting that stew in my mind, we're screwing over Becky, I kind of thought to myself, you know, this is kind of adding more development to Becky's character. Because when you think about it, her getting angry at this makes her human. And she knows it's her best friend. But this is her shot. This is something she had to fight for. And to see Charlotte, this woman, come in and just be given one. Charlotte didn't fight for it. Hell, before she left, she was already wrestling for that belt. So she's going to get a title shot, leave, and then come back and get another shot. She's been given shot like it's candy. Here's a shot. And she's giving it because she's Ric Flair's daughter. Well, Becky isn't related to anybody, and shots don't come as frequently for her. A shot for her is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And the frustration that she showed at the end of SmackDown is genuine.
Becky might lose because of this, which is bullcrap.
Right, but hear me out, because I was going somewhere with this. Imagine if she wins. Because think about this. We're all assuming now that it's the end of the world for Becky. We're all assuming now that, okay, there's no way in hell that she's walking out with the belt. Either Carmella's retaining or Charlotte's gonna win the belt. The odds are stacked against Bayley. Becky. Although, you know, this was Bayley in NXT. But the odds are stacked against Becky. What if she wins? Think about this. What if Becky manages to actually still pull off the victory? Imagine right now how big that reaction will be. Look, the obstacles are big. Like, the obstacles are huge. Becky winning just, it's less likely to happen now. But what if they do give it to her? What if all of this, and this is me giving SmackDown the benefit of the doubt, what if all of this is just more tension? More tension to make fans want to get behind Becky even more and to make the match that much more important. You see what I'm saying?
Because they want Charlotte to be 16X champ, woo.
And I see people talking about Becky Lynch turning heel. Let me put a stop to that right now. Becky Lynch turning heel is the dumbest thing they can do right now. That is literally something that will kill the women's division on SmackDown. Do not turn this woman heel. Do not turn her heel. Although the story might call for it, don't do it. Don't do it. If anyone's going to turn heel, if you had to turn one of them heel between Charlotte and Becky, I say turn Charlotte heel. I mean, Charlotte's going to fight Ronda Rousey at WrestleMania anyways. She should be the heel. Might as well turn her heel now. And honestly, a heel Charlotte versus Becky Lynch sounds amazing. I'm all for that. On SmackDown, let's go. Regardless, for me, and this is just my opinion, Becky should stay babyface. She is literally the most loved, beloved female on your roster. Why would you turn her heel? For what reason? Don't do it. Asuka, see, and that's the thing that kills me too. You don't have anybody to fill her shoes if you turn her heel. Because Asuka would have been the person to do it, but you killed her. Asuka has no momentum. If anyone should be turning heel, it's Asuka. Asuka needs that heel turn more than Charlotte and Becky. But whatever, you know, if you're going to turn Charlotte or Becky heel, it should be Charlotte. Keep Becky babyface. Don't turn her heel. That would be a mistake. And people talking about her getting angry, that's not a hint for a heel turn. That's just her being human. Think about this. Her getting angry at Charlotte getting a title shot? Weren't you angry when she won the match? I was angry. You know, I was just like, really? We couldn't let Becky get her opportunity? Really? Weren't you a little upset? Okay. So why can't Becky be upset? She's human. It's relatable. I'm right there with her. Now, if they have her cheat to get the championship, if they have her do some underhanded things, I don't know if I'm going to like that.
Keep her how she is. Let her show emotion. Let her be upset. Let her go up to Charlotte and tell her, you had to come back and get another opportunity. You had to come back and steal my spotlight. You had to come do that. She won't be a heel for that. I'd be right there, right next to her. I'm just like, yeah, really, Charlotte? You couldn't wait? You had to come back and get another opportunity? So, we'll see what happens. Yeah, don't kill her. Don't kill her by turning her heel. Keep Becky as a babyface. If you gotta turn someone heel, turn Asuka heel. But give me your thoughts about this. SmackDown was good. SmackDown had me all in my feelings at the end of that show. I was like, God damn it, Charlotte. Why the hell did you have to get that title shot? This is Becky's time. This is Becky's time. You know? But we'll see. What do you guys feel about this? Give me your thoughts about SmackDown. Let me get some... Let's see. Chat comments here. Now I see people complaining about the Super Chats. Listen, I just want to let people know that I appreciate you for your Super Chats. And you can donate anytime you want. Because quite frankly, sometimes... Listen, to be fair with you, the Super Chats help me get through Raw. These Raw reviews that I do are horrible. Sometimes, you know, when I'm making my thoughts and the Super Chat comes in, it does get kind of annoying, but it's okay. That's me. That's the decision I made when I came up here. I knew where I wanted to let you guys have that voice. You will have your voice. I'm not taking away your Super Chats. I'm not. Okay? You are taking the time out of your day to watch me and donate, and therefore you deserve to have a platform for your voices. So, I'm cool with the Super Chats, honestly. I had no issues with that. The Fox. Heel Charlotte versus Becky would be great. Agreed, man. Leo. If Asuka is added, she will win the match. Becky and Charlotte will have the feud that was supposed to be Bayley versus Sasha. I guess. Jay Taylor, you act like Charlotte is garbage. I never said she was garbage. I just don't like the fact that she got the opportunity. It is frustrating when you think about Becky barely getting an opportunity. But again, the last opportunity she had was WrestleMania 33. That was the last shot she had at the Women's Championship. That's over a year and a half ago. Charlotte was going after the championship before she left on injury. And then she comes back and gets another one. Yeah, frustration. We don't hate Charlotte. We just hate the idea that it's that easy for her to get it, and it's that hard for Becky to get it. You get what I'm saying? Let's see here. Mike BT. This song makes me want to watch Neon Genesis. Let's see here. Sammy B. Right, sorry. Sammy Mee. It's not even Sammy, it's Samuel. Samuel Mee. Sorry, Sammy B. My bad. Charlotte heel turn. That'd be pretty cool. That's for sure. I would rather have a Charlotte heel turn than a Becky heel turn. Sonic X WWE The King. This show was lit. Tell me about it. Let's see. Oh yeah, Mr. Krabs. She and Alexa Bliss always getting opportunities over other women. Yeah, that is true. Let's see, Eric Gonzalez, did Triple H or Ryan Ward take over SmackDown again? Road Dogg just left. That's all that happens. Road Dogg just left and went to Raw, so it got better. I'm your dad, kid, 25. Heel Becky in NXT was amazing. Was she? I don't even remember. I don't even remember all that much about heel Becky. I remember babyface Becky, but heel Becky, not so much. Jarrett Taylor, SmackDown was good this week. Agreed, buddy. Agreed. Kevin Holden, Venom does not look good at all. Oh, the trailer? I saw it. It was pretty good. I thought it was interesting. Maybe I'm just a hardcore comic book fan that's easy to please. Gregory Gold, all this tension and hate I get makes me more suicidal. My depression. Ooh. It's worse now. Lord.
Damn, they know I read to you that much. Yikes. Notorious, Charlotte doesn't deserve it. I don't care if I get hate. She doesn't need it. Becky needs it more. A lot of people feel that way, buddy. Let's see here. I love SmackDown. Charles Sweater. I love SmackDown. Was like broke Matt. Say it was wonderful. Okay. Life with Zach. How was your day today? My day was fine, man. Thanks for asking. Ajax. Honestly, heel Becky and NXT didn't really do much. That's what I felt. I didn't think she did much as a heel in NXT. She didn't become really good until she turned babyface because she's a natural babyface. I feel that way. Let's see here. Goku Black. If Becky does not win the SmackDown Women's Championship, I will be pissed. That girl deserves it. I think a lot of people will be pissed. Permanent Press. SmackDown Live was good. So many positive comments for SmackDown. I love it. I love it. Completely opposite from Raw. Let's do a few more, then I'm going to get out of here. Joe James. I don't like how they told the story on commentary. Well, yes, Charlotte is Becky's best friend. Why shouldn't she be mad that Charlotte is in the match? Her chances go down in a triple threat situation. And then you have to think about the fact that Becky, once again, I'm repeating this till it goes into your head, she didn't get any opportunities for over a year, and Charlotte has gotten millions of them within a span of a year. So, of course, she's going to be pissed off. It makes sense. Fire Starheart. Glad to hear you had a good day today. Well, thanks, man. Braun Strowman. Go watch PewDiePie's video titled Important Message. Okay. Was that for someone? That was for Greg. Okay. Sorry about that. The Beat Jr. Charlotte reminds me of Roman Reigns. Both get too many opportunities. I'm not going to argue against that, honestly. I've been told that before, and I don't argue against it. I just like Charlotte better than Roman, because at least Charlotte has a character. Sammy B, SmackDown being 2 hours is such a positive. Even if it was a bad show, it still would have been better than Raw. Yikes, that's really telling Raw off. Were you saying that last year when SmackDown sucked? Were you? Let's see here. One more. Benny Brockington. Watch this, guys. Benny says, I went to SmackDown Live. Great show. Live overall, the show was good. It's time for Becky Balboa to be on top again with the title. What was the reaction like in terms of when Charlotte won? How did the crowd receive it? I'm very curious to know how the crowd received that, because, quite frankly, I'm assuming nobody really liked it. So, there you go. Alright, guys. Thank you for watching. I'm gonna cut it off here. Don't want to keep you guys too long. I'm glad you enjoyed it. I'll see you tomorrow for, of course, NXT and Lucha Underground. As you guys know, usually Wednesdays are bad for me, but I do not have a session tomorrow. I'm actually free to come up here after Lucha Underground and NXT to do a live broadcast. So yes, I will be up here for NXT and Lucha Underground. But starting the 8th of August, that's unfortunately not going to be the case. So, but I will be up here tomorrow, and we'll go from there. Thank you guys for watching. I will see you guys next time right here in Europe Boys of X-Men's World. Like the video if you have...